It is indeed a big day for GLS Law College. On the e-platform of GLS Law College, we have somebody very special today, and that is none other than Ms. Menaka Gandhi, who is the name which is equivalent for the great work which has been done for animals, the silent sufferers across the globe. In India specifically, her work and her contribution is an epitome for anybody who is an animal lover or who wishes to work something in the field. Ma'am, we are so glad, we are so proud to have you here. We have the director of GLS Law College, Dr. Mayuri Pandya, who is the member expert appraisal committee. She is member into that Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Government of India, New Delhi, who is also a member of State Expert Appraisal Committee, that is SEAC, Department of Environment and Forest, Government of Gujarat, Gandhinagar. Ma'am is also a co-chair into Intellectual Property Rights, Gujarat Chamber of Commerce and Industry. And she is also the person who is a true environmental lover and environmental, we can say, warrior. And also has ELC under her worthy guidance, that is Environmental Law Clinic. And under that, ma'am, we are so happy that a worthy person like you have consented to come today. Over to you, Mayuri, ma'am.
Thank you, Payal. It is indeed my pride and privilege to welcome Mrs. Menaka Gandhi on the virtual platform of GLS Law College. Ma'am, I heartily welcome you on behalf of all the viewers, all our students, and the entire Gujarat Law Society family and the GLS Law College.
Thank you.
The subject, when we say that Mrs. Menaka Gandhi, the name needs no introduction.
Please don't introduce me. Let's carry on to the law. Please don't introduce me.
But still, we feel that as Payal rightly said, that you are the voice of the people. You are the voice of the people for animals. And especially Mahatma Gandhiji has said that if you want to see the progress of the nation or the moral progression of the citizen of the country, you must see the treatment that is given to the animals. And it is very unfortunate, the recent episode that happened in Kerala. We all are well aware of what happened with a pregnant elephant. Menaka Gandhi has worked so much for the welfare of the animals. Ma'am, I once again welcome you on behalf of all of us and would like to hear much more from you. We love you and we respect you for basically for the two reasons. The one, that you are the instrument to the, because Menaka Gandhi versus the Passport Authority of India is one of the judgment that has made the entire jurisprudence of the criminal justice has been changed, and you are the instrument to that. So that is a one reason. And another thing, the voice that you have given for the animal welfare. You are most welcome to this e-platform, and thank you so much for accepting our invitation, ma'am. I welcome you.
Thank you very much for asking. Some years ago, I had spoken to your college and to all the other colleges in India, law colleges, and asked them to start a section for animal welfare. And I was really happy to see that every law college agreed to teach their children animal welfare. In fact, the first animal welfare PhD was given to a young girl in the Orissa NLU, and I had gone for that. Now, the reason for this is very important. The most important thing to do in India, if we are going to do anything for animal welfare, is to train students in the laws. For two, three reasons. One is that the laws are very weak. So we must make up in quantity what we lack in quality. And we must build on this weak base with continuous pressure in the law courts so that we improve progress and bring in new laws all the time. In the last 10 years, we have been in court all the time with the help of very, very senior lawyers who have always done it pro bono. And it, the result has been a remarkable improvement in the our ability to handle cruelty legally and to ensure that things don't happen that are bad for people and animals. To give you an example, recently, because of high court decisions, the government has brought in rules regarding pet shops. Now, nobody, no city, nobody in the country can run a pet shop unless they are inspected and licensed by the state animal welfare board. Now, this is the result of a high court action. This, you're talking about the pregnant elephant in Kerala. Do you know that that week, not that month, 26 elephants were killed. 26 were killed, not died. In Odisha, in Assam, in Kerala. Kerala alone, 6 elephants were killed. Same way. Now, the point is that unless we have action on removing elephants from private ownership, unless we have a court action banning this, they will continue to die. They will continue to die. Now, we have rescued, in fact, the government of Pondicherry has rescued an elephant called Lakshmi from, she had all her 4 feet were damaged. And she had been kept for 50 years in a temple begging every day. Usko sir par maro, usun dudh aati hai, 100 rupay de do, soon niche rakhenge. And we've had her put, the governor and the chief minister mil karke, they've had her put into a forest. Now there's a huge movement that she should be returned to the temple because this is anti-national to take away elephants. Now we need a government high court, I mean, we need a high court order to allow this elephant to survive in the forest. So children need to learn how to protect the country through laws and the creation of laws. Therefore, you are extremely important to me. Would you like to ask any questions? I mean, I can go on forever. The next thing I want to say is, and something you should understand properly. In America, the FBI has, in 2019, put animal cruelty on their checklist for heinous crimes, on their watch list. Now, what does this mean? This means that if any small town in America, if somebody beats an animal or kills it or is mean to it, they immediately, if the police get to know, they immediately go on to the FBI watch list. Now, what is a watch list? A watch list is a list which says, ye jo aadmi hai, this man is going to be trouble later on. So therefore, we should keep a watch on his activities. And the reason for that is, they have found that anybody who is mean to animals and goes out of their way to do cruelty to them is always going to be mean to people, always. When they have done studies on criminals in jails, for heinous crimes, that is for violence, rape, murder, robbery with violence, etc. They have found that the perpetrator always started by being mean to animals. And us samay kisi ne kuch nahi bola. At that point, nobody said anything. So now we need to understand that there is a type of mentality. A woman will come out, she will beat 5 dogs in the gully, just like that. And her excuse is ki chichi karte, susu karte. But in actual fact, it's not that. It is because she's frustrated, she's angry with her own life, and she has to take it out on somebody weaker than herself. And this entire cruelty business that people indulge in is about power, a power upon the weak. And they will utilize the same cruelty on children, on women. Therefore, it is very important that we get law students every year who know the laws, who are not afraid to apply them, who expand their hearts and minds in order to understand this belief in cruelty. I'll give you one example. The most unlivable, according to surveys, the most unlivable place in the world is near slaughterhouses, 1 kilometer radius within slaughterhouses. And the reason for that is because the man who is inside killing animals the whole day, when he comes out, he's not afraid to drink, to beat, to rob, to be violent, because he's completely immune to violence. That is not where we want to go. In India, one survey has established that the most unlivable city in India is Rampur. And why Rampur? It has the maximum number of slaughterhouses, it has a knife industry, it has violence in it. What about the people who live in Rampur, who are peaceful citizens, who are wonderful Indians? They are in jeopardy all the time. Do we want that kind of mahal? No, we don't. But it is law students who are ultimately going to shape the way India progresses. I want to give you another example. During this COVID time, the people who have been the meanest, the smallest hearted, the people who have created the maximum trouble for everybody, are the heads of most society resident welfare associations, RWAs. Now we've had thousands of young people, 19-year-old, 18-year-old, 16-year-old, women mainly, stand up against them. They have these presidents, secretaries, and the group that has stood for election and won. They were bored, or they are bored. They have nothing to do. They cannot go out. So why not spend that time being mean to animals? Isko nikalo, isko na khilao, isko dande se maro, guard se hatwao, and being mean to women. This is usually an excuse to be mean to women as well, because women are most of the feeders. So it becomes, wo aurat pagal hai, wo khilati hai, wo she stood up to me, wo bahut tarike se baat nahi karti hai. All sorts of excuses, but every day I have to handle between 50 to 100 cases of RWAs. And in each case, when I speak to them, they back down, because bullies are also cowards. So when we tell them that we are going to use the law, not of animal welfare, but of women harassment, then immediately they change, immediately. But instead of just me doing it and Gauri doing it, why not have each one of you stand up, know the laws and utilize them? If we have weak animal welfare laws, we have very strong laws that protect women. And I know that I made most of them. So use those. Use 428, 429, which is punishable by 3 years in jail. And create, go to court, file PILs, even as students. Have moot courts so that people can learn the sensitivities of each case. Be an asset. You know, replace Menaka Gandhi with 1 billion Menaka Gandhi.
Ma'am, Menaka Gandhi cannot be replaced. Menaka Gandhi can be only the one. And I hope you are the inspiration to so many women, not only in India, but all over the world. And the work that you have done, it's a crusade. And you are a true crusader. And GLS Law will sure would like to join in this crusade for the animals.
So can you start with, in every college, let your law college start it. In every college, I want a small unit for animal welfare, and it should be recognized by the principal or the dean of the college, in which it is recognized so that if children pass out, the new children will take over. And they will then continue to educate the campus. They will get people in to talk. In most colleges now, have a small animal welfare group that looks after not only the animals locally, but also teaches, educates, and is responsive. Now, recently, we had a case in Ahmedabad where one man who was bored by being in, being locked up in COVID, he used to go to his second floor, take out a gun, and shoot animals at random. Now, it's young people who caught him, took him to the station. I'm thankful to the police that they immediately took action. I made the laws for air guns. They now have to be licensed. But you need to push that so that everybody who has an air gun has to get a license or surrender them. You know, we have to work in 1,000 different ways. I can talk forever, but Gauri will give you the laws, and I suggest you ask her and grill her.
I have only one question to ask. When you started for the people for animal, you know, whenever we start anything, there is something, some inspiration, something that must have inspired you so much to go for all the students and who would like to know about it.
I always did animal work. I got my first dog bite when I was 6. So trying to feed an animal. And my mother didn't seem particularly perturbed. I got my 14 injections in the stomach, which I screamed and screamed about. And then when I had a certain amount of power, I changed those 14 injections in the stomach to 6, 5 in the arm. That was me, only because I remember those 14. But the point is that when my husband died, he left me a very small amount of money, 8 lakhs. And I used that money to build India's first animal hospital, Sanjay Gandhi Animal Care Center, and in 84. And then just worked at the hospital for many years. I also stood for election and did many other things. You know, very few people know that I run 5 orphanages for children as well. And 16,000 children have passed through my orphanages and got jobs in Bhadohi. But in 91, 5 of my friends got together and they made People for Animals and gave it to me as a gift, saying that now it's time for you to expand. And so I made an organization, and I had 1 typewriter and 10,000 people. And I used to do a show called Heads and Tails on television, which showed you how a chicken became a chicken sandwich on Doordarshan. And that became very popular and continued for 5 years. And as a result, the movement grew. And now I'm just so lucky that during this COVID time, I have actually seen lakhs and lakhs of people come out, feed animals, fight for them, not take any rubbish, go to court. You know, it's been a wonderful experience for me because I didn't expect so many people to come out. But we need to now, you know, increase this with teaching them law. So even if your students, give me your best student and let them make 30-second or 60-second YouTube packages, you know, where they sit down and they explain, for instance, if the RWA shuts the gate and doesn't allow you to feed the dogs, what should you do? And tell me the law. So you take 100 questions and you put those answers, those detailed answers, talk to Gauri. What happens if you see, for instance, a chickens being sold on the road in those cages? What is the law? What is the law regarding pet shops? What is the law regarding a breeder? There's so many income tax laws also involved in that. Now, this morning in Bharatpur, 2 income tax, very small people, I mean, probably peons or something in that office, locked the door, took sticks and beat 3 dogs to death and filmed themselves doing so. What can I do with that case? No, let them answer these questions, film them. And that would be a great service for India because lots of people want to take action, they just don't know what to do. Anyway, I'm talking too much. You need to go to bed.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was very informative and very inspiring. I'm sure that by all the students who are viewing, they will sure they are ready to make those kind of small YouTube clips, and we will sure take up this under our environmental law clinic. I promise on behalf of all my students.
Because you're an environmentalist, let them also make clips on. Suppose somebody in Ahmedabad sees a person cutting a tree. What should they do? You know, let's give them, tell them what the law is. Even trimming of trees in parks often kills the tree. I don't think you know that a lot of malis, sarkari malis, cut the tree. They don't trim it. They cut it so hugely because they sell the wood to the cremation ground. So they make an extra income. So how to stop them? You know, things like that. Think of every conceivable situation and make little clips on it. That would be so valuable. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for accepting our invitation. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. And we're going to talk to Gauri now.
Hello, Gauri ma'am.
Gauri, yeah, ma'am. Hi. Can you hear me? Yeah.
We can hear you. I welcome you on behalf of GLS Law College and Gujarat Law Society. We are very much eager to hear you so far as the animal laws are concerned.
Correct. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dr. Pandya and Dr. Mehta, to actually organize this. It's always lovely to talk to law students because when it comes to enforcement of animal protection laws, there's nobody more relevant than young law students who can, you know, take the bait forward. I would perhaps, just like Mrs. Gandhi said, and I was hearing background, also request maybe at some point we have in GLS Law College something similar to what we have in NALSAR and NLSUI Bangalore, a concrete animal law center. Actually, it all started a few years back when we went to the Bar Council of India and we wanted them to start an animal law course, an optional subject, just like an environmental law is offered as an optional subject.
You will be happy to know that in state of Gujarat, I'm with proud mm-hmm. I can say that our university is the first university, because Bar Council of India has given as one of the electives. In Gujarat, we are the first university to take up it in curricula, animal laws, before 5 years.
We have animal law subject, ma'am.
Okay.
We have with us Gauri Mulekhe ji, who is the trustee of People for Animals and also consultant of animal welfare laws of India. And she is, as she said, she is working in association with Menaka Gandhiji for the Association of Animal People for Animals. And she has done so many PILs along with Menaka Gandhiji. Those who have studied, our senior students, those who have studied animal laws, they must have studied that any of the things that you just have to remember for your animal law paper. If you don't remember anything, you just have to write, it is Menaka Gandhi versus Union of India or Menaka Gandhi's petitions that has been filed. So it has really helped you a lot just to remember a name. And Gauri Mulekhe ji has been working with Menaka ji since long, and she has done many work for animals. She has served as a resource person and a trainer for the state police for more than 8 states, and has held workshops on animal welfare at the National Judicial Academy, Bhopal, and all the state judicial academies of Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Himachal Pradesh, and for Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Rules 2017, the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, specifically for Dog Breeding and Marketing Rules 2017, and the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Pet Shop Rules 2018 were notified by the Government of India because of the hardcore efforts of Gauri Mulekhe ji. Ms. Mulekhe has been nominated by several state governments to be a member of Slaughterhouse Monitoring Committee, Animal Birth Control Implementation, which have been constituted in compliance of orders passed by the Honorable Supreme Court of India. She has worked extensively across various states to spread awareness about animal welfare and ethical treatment of animals. And she is also a member of Uttarakhand State Animal Welfare Board. She was awarded the prestigious Nari Shakti Puraskar 2018 by the President of India for the great contribution in the field of animal welfare advocacy, And in 2018, she was awarded the Distinguished Alumni Award in the field of animal welfare advocacy by Lucknow University. Not only that, in addition to that, 2018, she received the Outstanding Animal Protection Award from the Human Society International at Kansas City, USA. And she also is the recipient of the Lush Prize of 2017 in London for her enormous contribution towards reducing unnecessary use of animals in laboratories. So, ma'am, it is like the list will keep going on and on because you have worked so hard and so profusely in this field. Over to you, ma'am. We are asking questions.
Sure. We'll try and keep it as interactive as possible because lectures bore everybody. But I would like to begin by saying that India has one of the best sets of animal welfare laws, starting straight from our constitution, where there are provisions under 51 AG, which imposes a duty on every citizen of the country to be kind to animals, to be considerate about the animals that live in our environment. There's Article 48 and 48 A, which impose a duty on the state governments to form policies which are humane and which look after, you know, the benefit of and welfare of our animals. And starting from that constitution, I mean, way back, you know, 70 years ago, people thought of, you know, including animals as sort of, you know, living, feeling creatures in our environment. That actually just goes on to say how ahimsa is a part of Indian culture inalienably. No matter how much, you know, the other countries may talk of animal welfare, these values in the Indian constitution are very unique. So starting from there, we then had sets of laws. The parliament framed the 1960 Act of Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. That also has an interesting story. It was introduced like a private member bill by a Tamil Nadu MP called Srimati Arundhati Dale. And after that, it got admitted by Jawaharlal Nehruji as a bill from the Ministry of Agriculture, and it became law. That was the first time in a very progressive act, which actually makes every violation of hitting or kicking an animal or making an animal perform in a circus illegally without certain minimum standards and guidelines and registrations, making animals, you know, get experimented upon or using them in bail gaadis or boogies, everything was thought about. So it's a very thought out act. It's a very comprehensive act. It's like a bedrock. Every other provision of law in any other act that protects animals has its roots in the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. So this act basically at that time was amazing, and it had 10 rupees fines and 50 rupees fines, and Section 38 has 100 rupees fines. So in that era, it meant a lot. Because along with that was 3 months penalty, 3 months imprisonment as well, which is optional. So at that time, it was a wonderful law. Slowly and gradually, 10 rupees and 50 rupees and 100 rupees started meaning nothing. And now we are very happy to let you know that the government is actually considering to upgrade the penalties and to make them better. And that's all happened because of certain Supreme Court orders. Three orders to be precise, where the Supreme Court has asked the government of India to revise the penalties to basically inflation correct them so that the law still becomes a deterrent. Regardless of the penalties, it still remains the, you know, the most wonderful act that we have, because whether we are able to penalize the accused adequately in terms of money or not, we are always able to remove the animal from an abusive situation, which is very important. An animal can be seized by the police, because the police is generally under Section 32 and 34, you would see. The police is empowered under this act to take action, to seize, to search, to enter any property. The state government has the power to notify other bodies also, but police has the power under this act. This particular act has chapters, and its strength, its core strength, is in the rules that are made under the Act. There are about 15 sets of rules under the Act, starting from draft and pack animals rules, which deal with buggies and ghoda gadis and bail gadis and how much weight can be carried by these gadis, whether they have, when they have tires, when they don't have tires. So there's a whole chart which can be used if there is a case of overloading on bail gadis or horses or whatever. We've used this act, this provision, very effectively in our petition regarding abuse to horses in the Vaishno Devi Yatra. So they are now the SPC has been made over there in Jammu, close to Jammu actually. It's a place called Riyasi. So an SPC has been made, and we've used this provision to bring relief to about 20,000 horses over there. So, and most people don't even know that this provision exists. So, being young academic minds in colleges, I would request all of you to just go through it. It's a very progressive and very... slaughterhouse rules, which say that every animal that needs to be slaughtered has to be stunned first. Stunning is a procedure by which an animal kind of is made to lose consciousness, so it doesn't feel the cut when it is actually put, whether it's a goat or a chicken or a buffalo, whatever it is, it has to be stunned first. It's a mandatory provision. The sad thing in our country is, with all the wonderful laws, the awareness level is so low that it remains to be enforced properly. Then we've got rules which have recently been made, such as the pet shop rules, the dog breeding rules, the livestock market rules. These are animals which are caught up in trade, basically used commercially by people for their own interests. And at this time, to regulate it is very important, not only from the monetary perspective that people are actually commercializing these animals to a large extent, but also the Law Commission of India came up with a report about 3 years ago, where they said that this trade, which we think is just a roadside corner trade where somebody is selling a few rabbits and maybe a few bajrigars, is actually not small. It amounts to tens of billions of rupees in India. If you look at all the chidiya bazaars and all the khargosh bazaars, and they also do a side deal of wildlife trade, which is illegal. So regulating them and keeping in tabs on them, prescribing minimum standards for them, is very, very important. Hence, the government of India came up with these sets of rules, which are now very relevant, because during the lockdown, every state came up with an order that all, whenever the lockdown reopens, there will not be any permission for unregistered pet shops or dog breeders to reopen at all. Lessons learned from the Wuhan wet market. Because, you collect a lot of species of animals and you put them in one place and then you sell them. They basically exchange pathogens. They all, viruses jump from one species to the other and mutate and cause a lot of... There's a lot of science to say that several species, and especially wild species, put together in one place is like a ticking time bomb from a human health point of view. Hence, every state came up with an order that after the lockdown restrictions reopen, no pet shop or dog breeder will be allowed to reopen unless it's registered with the state animal welfare board. Anyway, reminds me of one more very important aspect of the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, that it actually makes the creation of Animal Welfare Board of India mandatory. Section 4, you would see, lists the constitution, and section 9 lists the functions of the Animal Welfare Board of India. This is the apex body, just like the apex body of animal welfare in the country. It has some advisory role and it also has some regulatory role. Currently, it's being chaired by a joint secretary of Animal Husbandry Department. But otherwise, you generally have an expert on the subject heading the body. And this is a body that gives advice to all state governments and the central government about any new policy that is coming up. And policies are always coming up regarding animals. Everybody wants to use them and everybody wants to go overboard because, I mean, an animal cannot complain. It can't say that, oh, you know, don't cram me in a very small cage only because you want to maximize your profits, just like battery cages and hens, billions of hens being crammed into battery cages. So, or pigs kept in gestation crates. You know, these are all industrial animal agriculture which is seeping into the country, and policies are being made by the central government, by state government. So advice from the Animal Welfare Board of India is critical. So Animal Welfare Board of India is a very important body formed under the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. Further, the Supreme Court took it one step forward and said that not only the Animal Welfare Board of India, you need to have state animal welfare boards also. And state animal welfare boards were given certain responsibilities, such as dog breeders and pet shops actually have to be registered with the state animal welfare boards. This body doesn't have a defined constitution or or functions, but I think there's some problem with the video, but the audio seems to be fine, so I'm going to go on speaking. So these constitution and function of state animal welfare boards is now being prescribed by the Supreme Court again, and that petition of ours is pending. So like you've heard me saying petition and court so many times, now is a good time for new young lawyers to specialize in animal law, because a lot of litigation is coming up. If you just master the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, the issues such as animal sacrifice, the issues such as livestock agriculture, the intensive animal farming, the issues such as breeding and trading of animals. These are very litigious issues, and there's a lot of scope for young lawyers to actually be useful and do a whole lot of good in a larger sense. This is not only important for your personal satisfaction, but you'd be helping a lot of animal welfare organizations who are looking for experienced and young, knowledgeable animal law experts. I'll tell you something. When I was back in 2010, when I wanted to do something against animal sacrifice, which used to happen in Uttarakhand, about 2 lakh animals per annum used to be just slaughtered and thrown off the hills. Buffaloes and goats and all kinds of animals just slaughtered to please the gods, and I knew that it was not provisioned for in law. Killing animals for food for mankind is provisioned in Section 11(3) of the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, but killing them for appeasement of God is not a reason that is justified in the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. So I went to Nainital High Court and I just took my case. I had made the notes, I had made a brief, and I respectfully approached a lot of senior counsels and some juniors as well, and everybody just threw me out. They said, are you mad? You're going against the people's sentiments, and this is the culture, and nobody is going to support it, and it's a rubbish petition, and you can't do anything about it, and we're not going to support something which is so anti-people, and it's the culture of Devbhoomi Uttarakhand and all that nonsense. And I said, I also belong to Devbhoomi Uttarakhand. It's not my culture at all. So no lawyer was willing to take my brief. So I decided to argue the matter in person. And within 1 year, the petition was disposed with a very positive order, and animal sacrifice was banned in Uttarakhand. Ever since then, we've done a lot of public awareness. We've, instead of animal sacrifice of thousands of buffaloes, we've held blood donation camps for medical purposes. We've switched to other things, such as instead of bringing a bhensa from each village, why don't you get a doli for the goddess from each village? Just getting creative and actually etching a new culture, which is more humane, which is more progressive, which is more scientific, because that's one of our constitutional values also. just to develop a scientific temper in people and to get them to nurture a spirit which is humane. So that was one point where I realized that having a good lawyer really, really is important. And most of the animal welfare organizations suffer from a good legal counsel on animal protection laws. Whenever we have to brief somebody, we have to really start from scratch because they've never read it before they've encountered us. So it would be really nice if the new crop is all ready to take on some cases in district courts, in high courts, we've got matters in the competition commissions because there's some competitive practices among animal traders that are against the Competition Act. There are cases in National Green Tribunal, huge number of cases in National Green Tribunal, which are related to animals basically, but are connected with the Schedule Acts of the NGT. So there's so much scope that you can learn hands-on. You can start with doing or helping with some research with an animal organization. We need a lot of researchers for various subjects. It would be great if we can get an animal law center up and running, and a few can come in intern with us and do some research and add some value to the 50-60 odd petitions that are pending with us. And it is just good value addition where you also get to learn something. This is basically one about Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. But the other act, the second act that I want to talk about, is the Wildlife Protection Act. Now, Wildlife Protection Act was made in 1972 by Indira Gandhiji when she wanted to rein in and control all the Raja Maharajas who were doing shikar all over the place and hunting tigers and elephants and rhinos as trophies. So once this act was brought in, all the Indian species of wild animals were listed in four schedules, and these four schedules at the end of the act are the ones that are protected animals. And the spirit of the animal, the act, is protection, basically conservation. Conservation and welfare sometimes doesn't go hand in hand. The concepts are a little different. Like one would say, if an elephant is a cripple or a deer has got hurt in the forest, in a sanctuary, in a national park, then you don't do anything. You just leave it alone. That's the principle of conservation. If you don't interfere with nature at all, you just leave the habitat alone, you just let it be, and it'll take care of itself. The fittest will survive and will take the species forward. The weaker ones will fade away, that like the Darwin's theory of evolution. But welfare goes one step forward and interferes and gives relief to every single animal that's in pain or is a victim of anything. So Wildlife Conservation Act works more on the conservation angle. Wildlife Protection Act works more on the conservation angle. And for wild animals, we consider, since that's the law, very important to maintain habitats as sacrosanct. No habitat should be disturbed. People should not be allowed inside wild animal habitats. Nature should take care of itself and heal itself. While protection or welfare is more for companion animals, such as dogs on the streets and cows and farm animals and pet animals, they require more of protection and welfare and human intervention, because these are animals that live around us. They are dependent on us. They look up to us for protection and healing. But wild animals run away from us. That's the basic difference. The human interference is not sought by wild animals, while companion and farm animals require it heavily. So, I'm just giving you a bird's eye view of the concepts there are in animal welfare. You're going to have to do a lot more reading and research on it to understand it fully. Now our courts have gone to the extent of saying animal rights, which is a third concept. It started with Justice Radhakrishnan's Jallikattu judgment in 2014, where he says that under Article 21 has to be read with Section 3 of the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. Not only is it a duty of every citizen to give relief to animals, but it is that duty actually becomes like a right of the animal to live in a healthy environment, and also the right of a human being to live in an environment where unnecessary pain and suffering is not caused to any animal in one's environment. Like, it would be my right under Article 21 to live in an environment where misery is not being caused to other animals. So that jurisprudence has developed even further through Justice Rajiv Sharma's judgment of High Court Nainital, where he has directed the government to explore how the right to life can be extended to animals. And let me tell you that these are extremely progressive laws or judgments or pronouncements. And these are, the US is still struggling. There's a habeas that somebody has filed regarding an orangutan, but it's just not succeeding. Even up to the Supreme Court, it's just not succeeding. It lost to a count of 4-1. One judge said that, yeah, it makes sense, but it's maybe still not time for it yet. And the other 4 turned it down. So our courts, our judiciary being so progressive as to not only going to the extent of saying that it's a duty of people to protect animals, but to say that it's the right of the animal to be protected is just amazing. So it makes this field of law extremely, it has far-reaching effects. It has it has a way to go, There's no saturation coming into this field yet. And there's a lot of professional and spiritual satisfaction that one might get from working for the protection of those creatures who can't even come around and say thank you. They wouldn't perhaps even know that you saved them, but the love and the blessings that you get out of, just helping one little dog being chased or harassed by an RWA or one municipal corporation trying to, eradicate dogs or some misguided attempt at, removing dogs from a colony or something, by solving that, or assisting in that or being a part of that solution, you would feel so much more happiness at a deeper level. Then these are the two acts, the main acts that we were talking about, the Wildlife Protection Act and the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. But there is a wide variety of other statutes also that actually have provisions which are very relevant for animal welfare. Such as in 2006, the Parliament came up with the Food Safety and Standards Act. The Food Safety and Standards Act, one would think it's all about khana peena, but it's not. It's about slaughter also. And the registration and licensing regulations of 2011 of the Food Safety and Standards Act tell you all about how meat shops have to obtain licenses, how meat shops have to run their businesses, how slaughterhouses have to run their businesses, how meat packaging industries have to get licensed and run their businesses. And earlier, the power of giving licenses to slaughterhouses and meat shops, which was with the Urban Development Department, through this act, has come to the Food Safety Department, which is a part of the Health Department, you can say, at the central government level. So, it's not only a shift in perspective that from Shehri Vikas, from urban development, it's come into health, but it's also a progression in thinking. You're connecting food not just with an amenity which is available, like roads and, toilets and hospitals or whatever, not hospitals, but general public facilities, but it's looked at from a health point of view. Food has to have an unmistakable link with health. So bringing about this act, which had an overriding effect on all other statutes, we gave the licensing regime of all meat shops and slaughterhouses to the Food Safety Department, which comes under health. Now they have a more sophisticated perspective of putting minimum standards, like how should stunning be done, how should the floor of the slaughterhouse should be, how should the roof of slaughterhouse be, what kind of anti-mortem, post-mortem certificates a doctor has to make to certify that an animal is fit for slaughter, what kind of packaging should be done, how to transport an animal from a livestock market to a slaughterhouse. All these are conditions in the food safety and standards regulations, which every food business operator has to follow. Food business operator, again, is a very interesting definition. You must read it in the Food Safety and Standards Act. An FBO is any person who is basically involved in any part of the process of creating food, not necessarily commercially. Even if I'm maybe doing a langar in a gurdwara, I'm a food business operator. So any person who is involved in any process of food preparation or distribution is a food business operator, has to obtain a license from the Food Safety and Standards Department. Again, a very badly enforced law, because the department is very short-staffed and everybody is just, overwhelmed with the amount of work and few staff people, and hence more aware people in the market asking people for their FSSAI licenses will get this act a little bit of a boost. So a very important act there. Motor Vehicles Act has some important points about how to transport animals, what kind of vehicles can transport animals, what kind of a ramp is required to load animals and to unload animals and to, do various things. The Motor Vehicles Act, again, has a lot of important sections which are related to animals. The Indian Penal Code, one would think, also has some sections. However, IPC was made with a different mindset. When IPC was actually being written, perhaps, the lawmakers saw animals as property. And that is why Section 428 and 429, if you read them, they read like property. As in, if the animal is less than 50 rupees worth, then it would be, a non-cognizable offense and under Section 428 and available, of course. And if the animal is more than 50 rupees, then it will be a violation of 429. And worth of the animal was actually important. And the language says if somebody has mutilated, beaten, kicked an animal to render it useless. Hence, an animal can only be protected or need only be protected if it is useful. So useless and useful and the amount given show that at that time, jurisprudence was not on the welfare angle at all. And the lawmaker took the liberty of defining animal as any other property, like a car or a generator or something, which would have a certain amount of use for the people, for the owner, and it would have a worth, some tag, price tag on it. Depending on that, the case would be booked. But after the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, we know that we are actually giving them and elevated, we're making them worthy of welfare, just like human rights. It's not really right, but it's welfare. It's our duty to protect them, that kind of thing. It's not just about a table and chair sort of property, but it's about something living, breathing, something that can feel pain, something that is capable of suffering. So that suffering should not be caused. So the sentiment of the two acts you would see is very different. Because every department has its own mindset when they're writing the policies and when they're framing the laws, they have their own thoughts. So that is what you would see in the Ministry of Home Affairs. Then there are some sections of nuisance that are applicable on animals, section 268 and 269, which are generally applicable on meat shops or RWAs or, who are either slaughtering animals and causing nuisance in their areas and not, disposing carcasses in a proper manner, or maybe spreading there's a danger of spreading diseases if birds are not checked for avian influenza, or pigs are not checked for swine flu, and antemortem and postmortem is not done as per the prescribed standard. So that again is the sentiment is more of nuisance, you know, under IPC. Food safety is more about consumer thingy, you know, how a consumer has to be safeguarded from a food business operator. Food business operator should be regulated. Here it's about let's just keep law and order and let's not cause nuisance and respect each other's properties, whatever they might be worth. Then there are, like Mr. Gandhi mentioned, the Arms Act, where you know, lately you must have seen all these TikTok, and thankfully it's been banned. But TikTok and Instagram and Facebook, they all come up with heinous, dirty little videos showing torture of animals. And so many of these people actually make these videos. They torture these animals. Lately, we saw one where a monkey was being hung, given phansi by somebody in Telangana or Andhra Pradesh or some such. They make these videos only for public, just to catch attention, get more likes, become, you know, just to startle people, you know, with their absolute disgusting cruelty. Coming back to these cases, another case happened in Indore where somebody shot a few dogs to death. Similarly, these shooting things, you know, the incidents are not new. They keep happening. And that's why we're very grateful that the Arms Act actually came up with a set of regulations in 2016. And these regulations mandate that even, the air guns or air rifles or any air weapon needs to be registered and can be bought only from a licensed dealer. So the dealer has to buy a license and the owner has to get a registration. So unless that is there, you cannot have a gun. And it's very important that you have these provisions, because once a gun is not a toy, people start taking it seriously and using it less recklessly. Otherwise, they use it like a toy, whether it harms anybody or kills anybody is just taken in their stride. So these are important other acts that cover animals largely. And they're not just, sections. They mean life and death for animals. For so many animals. So it's really, really important that you look at any situation in its entirety. Don't just look at the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. There are so many statutes that apply in every situation, and you'd be able to see it clearly if you think laterally. So lateral thinking is very important, just to kind of think about the whole spectrum of legal framework that is at your disposal and what all applies in the situation from every perspective, because acts by different departments are made by different perspectives. They're all aligned the same way. Killing an animal, mutilating an animal, harming or injuring an animal is not tolerable in this country, and we have a whole spectrum of acts and laws to protect them. At the end of this, maybe, with the help of your teachers and coordinators, we'd be happy to send you some resource material, which you can use as an online repository and go to it and see, some important judgments of the high courts and some more, executive orders, etc., which should be of interest to you in this field. Maybe we can take some questions now, because I've been just talking like a monologue for an hour.
Hello, ma'am. Thank you. It was a very enlightening session. We have so many questions. Let's see how many we can take up with your kind consent. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, totally.
Okay, ma'am. There are few questions related to the recent incidents which you already mentioned, but then the students want to hear it in elaborative manner. I'll just ask you, just take it in as per your convenience. Ma'am, our faculty member who is taking animal law subject, she wants to ask Professor Sonal ma'am, that ma'am, don't you think that penalties and term of punishment for provisions relating to animal protection under Indian Penal Code and Criminal Procedure Code should be higher than what it is right now?
Correct. It should be higher. In fact, there is a committee that's been made by the central government to review the IPC penalties, and it also has animal protection sections of IPC in their schedule of what they're going to look at, and they're reviewing it. However, I have also more faith in the revision of penalties under the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, which is also underway. And that should give us a lot of, teeth in animal protection laws, because once these sections become cognizable, which most of them are not, and with a higher penalty, we'd be able to have better enforcement. IPC, yes, it's being reviewed by the MHA. But at the same time, Ministry of Animal Husbandry, Dairies, Fisheries and Animal Husbandry is also reviewing the PC Act. So both penalties should be up. Let's see. I mean, it's in process.
Thank you, ma'am. There is another question from Anuja Shimali. She wants to ask that despite of these rules and laws, slaughterhouses like the Diona Slaughterhouse still do not follow these rules and escape the law. So the making and implementation of the law needs to be stricter. So is there any guidelines for through which it can be done, as you suggested, or and as Mayuri ma'am rightly said, along with the conversation with Menka ma'am, that we are already having our environmental law. We can utter that, we will definitely have our civil anything that is related to animal protection. Can you suggest what we can join hands along with that?
So basically, in long, long ago, there was a man called Lakshmi Narayan Modi who went to the Supreme Court saying that slaughterhouses are very dirty, filthy, and they should all be shut down. Now, this, in the context of that, in 2012, I think, the Supreme Court came up with something called Slaughterhouse Monitoring Committee, which had to be made in every state under the chairmanship of the Urban Development Secretary. Now, this Slaughterhouse Monitoring Committee was given the task of checking all violations of slaughterhouses in their states. Now, again, like I said, in every one situation, there can be at least 15 different laws that are applicable. So nobody knew which law to apply, which not to apply, and what are the correct laws for slaughterhouses. So in 2016, actually, when the title Lakshmi Narayan Modi passed away and the title came to Common Cause because it was a batch matter, the Supreme Court again said that why don't all the respondents and petitioners get together and make a compendium of all the laws that are applicable on slaughterhouses. Incidentally, that compendium was made by me, and it was then passed by all the respondents and petitioners. And finally, it was mandated by the Honorable Supreme Court. That compendium is actually your key. It has all Water Act, Air Act, Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, Motor Vehicles Act. It just has everything. It has 24 statutes, which are mandatory for every slaughterhouse. And that is something that you need to have as a ready reckoner for all violations of slaughterhouses. Now, unless you read, now understand this, it's very easy to check, a chota sa dukaan ka murgi wala, who would not be part of a very big lobby and would perhaps be, subdued by the local thana very easily. But when it comes to big industries, big traders who have a lot of, power and money to throw around, you cannot just simply have, some random animal activist just go there to Devnar and say, this is really bad. Something ought to be wrong with it. Something has to be wrong with it. This is not correct. You have to know the correct provisions. So far, we've not had a good team in Mumbai or in several places, in most places, I'd say, to read the compendium and to actually figure out exact problems with every slaughter situation. If you do that and report it to the State Slaughterhouse Monitoring Committee, or go to the High Court, or go to, you know, the relevant competent agency for taking action in such violations, whether it's police or it's a food safety or it's the SPCB, the State Pollution Control Board. So you need to first figure it out. Just saying that, you know, this is a bad situation is not good enough. Like, we have been working extensively in the UP slaughter situation, and we've corrected it to a very large extent. And wherever we get complaints about certain slaughterhouse houses, the State Slaughterhouse Monitoring Committee sends a subcommittee to make a detailed report of what exactly is wrong with it. And our guiding light is the compendium. So I'd be happy to share the compendium and the Supreme Court's orders with you. And that's like a Bible when it comes to slaughterhouses. Somebody has to read the Bible, because unless you read it, you wouldn't know what the Lord is saying. So it's an important document. And you can check any slaughterhouse using that compendium and correct the situation very effectively with that. And you'd be able to convince the authorities that something is wrong with it. Because slaughter is allowed under the Act, under Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act 11, Part 3, Section 11, Subsection 3. Slaughter for animals is actually allowed for the purpose of food for mankind. But it has to be regulated, because even while doing so, you cannot inflict unnecessary pain and suffering. Hence, the regulations kick in. Now, those regulations can only be imposed if the person checking it knows the law.
Very true.
It's about 600 pages, that compendium, so I'm not going to go into explaining it right now. But let me tell you, it'll be an eye opener once you have that.
Yes, ma'am. It seems that we would love to have many other sessions with you, with your kind consent and having an association to join hands between different boards. And one more question that has been asked by our what is the role that has been played by the Forest Department in both cases, one of Kerala elephants and the other with in Kerala forest?
Okay, so State Forest Department is perhaps the most, if I can have the liberty to say that, they just like to brush everything under the carpet. So the tricky section in the Wildlife Protection Act is the Section 55, which says that a magistrate can only take cognizance of a wildlife crime. Can I just switch off the camera for a moment? I'll have to walk up to the car to get the charger. Yeah, so I'm going to keep speaking. So basically, the Section 55 says that any magistrate can only take cognizance of a wildlife crime if a forest officer gives in a complaint. Now, the forest officer in this case is the same department who are working under the same set of officers. They wouldn't want the matter to be thrown up, and they would want everything brushed under the carpet. In Kerala, for the past 4 years, we have been investigating, and we found that there are about 400 elephants which are without ownership certificates under Section 42 and 40 of the Wildlife Protection Act, which are mandatory to have if you have any wild animal in your custody. So these elephants do not have those ownership certificates, and they're all owned by the Devaswams, the big temples in Kerala, which are run by trusts, and these trusts are headed by the district commissioner, the deputy commissioner, or the DC. Now, the government has no option but to close the case or not take it forward, because if they prosecute, then they would have to prosecute their own DCs, because they have the custody of these illegally kept elephants. So besides this also, there are cases such as declaration of vermin. Like Kerala decided to kill all the wild boar without permission from any department or without really taking the consent of the Ministry of Environment and Forests, which they should, they decided to kill all the elephants and all the wild boar, and they gave people free, free hand to use whatever they wanted to. Now, in this present case that happened of the pregnant elephant, it was a vermin sort of issue. It was a snowball of a vermin issue. The people obviously can't wrestle with a wild boar. They cannot look at a wild boar, and they can't like find it even in the daytime because it's a nocturnal animal. So they decided to put, and that's what they generally do in all other states also where they illegally kill wild boar. They put explosives in edible items, or they put poison baits out in the forest, and these wild boar come and eat them and die. In this case, the elephant had it. It was perhaps non-target, but a violation anyway. The forest department tried its level best to brush it under the carpet. We are trying to put in a special prosecutor in this case, but it seems that it would have to finally come higher up. We've also supported a petition in the Supreme Court against all these vermin declarations that the government has been doing, because these are the ones which are getting a large number of animals killed illegally. Non-target animals get killed illegally, which is a big concern actually. So in Telangana, well, when I spoke to the DFO, he tried to convince me that the monkey was actually at fault. So it's actually very disheartening when you see the protectors of forest have kind of not developed an aptitude for protection and welfare so much, especially in the forest department, because they're so used to facilitating hunting like they used to do till 1972. So the sentiment in the department is still to facilitate hunting. They're more into, minor forest produce and getting forest and wood and other forest produce monetized. They would rather not take much care in protection of wild animals because it just doesn't interest them so much, and most of them are not even aware of how which laws to use. So that's a sad thing. Does that answer the question?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Now you video is working, still not?
In a moment. Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Just give me one minute.
Okay. Sure. Ma'am, what are your views on avoiding misleading animal testing? As in all animal tests, the animal with the complex emotions that very inanimate in the laboratory equipment. So what do you have to say about that?
Sorry, I didn't get the question.
I don't have.
What are your views on avoiding misleading animal testing in the laboratories?
Okay, now testing of hello?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Okay, no, my battery is actually totally running out.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, wait. Yeah, okay. I'm back.
Yes, ma'am.
So, I'm actually couldn't avoid an appointment with a lawyer only.
Yes, so, you are at work and you are just helping us in this field.
Oh, Baba.
Shall I just go to the next question, ma'am? Gauri, ma'am, am I audible? Yes, I was just telling students
okay.
That if...
So we were talking about experiments. We were talking about the experiments on animals. So earlier it was actually... Sorry?
Yes, ma'am. We are all ears. We are listening to you. You were mentioning something about earlier reference.
You know, many years ago. So many years ago. Yeah. So many years ago, it was actually, there was no choice. And when we were developing vaccines for malaria and for rabies and for, you know, various other antibiotics were being manufactured and tested, it was necessary and it was, there was no option but to test on animals because however, you know, meaningless it might be to check whether an animal is responding to a medicine or not, because it's not necessarily useful for as a data on effectiveness of that vaccine or medicine on humans. But it was safe, it was considered safer to do so. And that's how the scientific, you know, thing has progressed, that they've always tested on animals first. That has somehow, in the present day and age, become slightly obsolete. Because now you get 1,000 genes on one, you know, chip the size of a SIM card. You get mannequins of animals, which would replace the use of live animals for pharmacology and pharmacy experiments and research. You get so many more kinds of other gadgets now, which give you the same result as you would get in testing on an animal. So the need for maintaining animal houses by pharmacy colleges and medical colleges and veterinary colleges and dental colleges have all become obsolete. And they can easily replace it by using alternatives. Like you've got alternatives for meat now, you've got alternatives for milk, you're now getting alternatives for eggs, which are all non-animal, more human-friendly, plant-based and progressive. The same way you get, you know, gadgets and, you know, digital helps or alternatives. Which can replace animals totally from a laboratory. However, if one needs to use animals in a laboratory, there is a two-step process. One is to form an institutional animals ethics committee, which is the IAEC, at the level of the institution, and then to get it registered with the CPCSEA, which is a committee for the purpose of supervision and regulation of experiments on animals, CPCSEA. This is, you know, in chapter 7, section 17 of the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. This body is a regulatory body that regulates all the laboratories wherever animals are either cut up for teaching, because a lot of dissection used to happen while teaching, wherever animals are used for research purposes, like the tobacco industry uses a lot. So that's one reason to give up smoking, because all those you know, new flavors or whatever they try, they make, they actually test on beagles. Beagles are dogs with those long ears. Their gene is closest to humans or what they say. So they test all smokes and all kinds of cigars and all kinds of nonsense on beagles. And with those, you know, lungs that finally give way, they just kill those dogs, you know, euthanize them. Horrible, horrible deaths these animals die because they are subjected to, because they're given cancer, then their cancers, you know, try to, you know, make okay with this medicine or that. So there are three kinds, basically. It's either testing, it's research, or it's education. Three major ways where animals are used in laboratories. So a lot of animal usage from laboratories for education has been removed. Like when I was a child, not a child, I was in class 10 in ICSE, we had to cut up a frog and you know, a fish or a cockroach, you know, in our biology practicals. It was such a useless piece of education, I must say. It never helped me ever in life. You know, knowing the anatomy of a frog really doesn't take you anywhere in life at that stage. where one would perhaps not be studying or pursuing biology ever in life. So teaching involved a lot of dissection, even in veterinary colleges, in pharmacy colleges, in dental colleges, which has all been removed now. Now they don't use any animals for teaching. Earlier, they used to bring live baby buffaloes and cut them up for teaching young doctors what an inside of a buffalo looks like. Like you can easily use a mannequin in these days. The kind of alternatives that are coming are so real that you would not know that it's actually an artificial animal that you're killing or looking at. The simulation programs also, it feels as if you're cutting an animal, but you're actually not. So, and these are replaceable. In fact, the good thing is that ICMR, Indian Council for Medical Research, is now making a center of excellence for alternatives in animal research in Hyderabad, which is called NARC. So that should take us one notch higher in scientific progress as well.
Thank you, ma'am. There are many questions which are getting repeated, so I'm just asking it to you in a combined way. Students are very eager to know that if police is not responsive in many of the cases, and it is very obvious that has been observed, that if police is not responsive or they are not supportive, which authority is to be contacted? As during pandemic, it has been observed that many residential societies do not support, and they have the bylaws for pet owners and stray dog. So how to deal with that, as police is extremely non-responsive in such cases? So do you suggest any way out for particular such situation?
Yeah, the key is escalation. If you've dialed 100 and the PCR has come, is not listening to you, you call up the SHO, the station head of the station officer. If he is unresponsive and he's saying, oh, you know, janwar ka mamla hai, mujhe nahi karna kuch, then you can go to the, circle officer. There has to be a reasonable and good person along the line. When you go from a station officer to a circle officer, if the circle officer doesn't listen, you go to the SP. Or these days officers are very responsive on Twitter. So I've used Twitter during the lockdown very, very effectively to get people to listen, because otherwise it's difficult to meet them all the time. But you can go to the SP of the district. If he is unresponsive, you can go to the DM, because the district magistrate or the district collector is actually the chairperson of the district SPCA also. So in that capacity, it is his job to ensure the enforcement of all the provisions of Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. So it's an important, it's as important to escalate your complaint as important it is to make. Just giving a complaint in writing to the Thana and forgetting about it does not make sense. You have to escalate it, go higher up, and ensure that it's filed as an FIR if you're putting the correct sections. And if you've written the FIR decently and properly, an FIR has to be written. These days, we've encountered a lot of people who did not know how to write an FIR. And when you if it's an emotional account of, how animals are being troubled in the world, it does not have the ingredients of a first information report. As in, this incident happened in this place at this time, and here I saw it, and here's the evidence, and these are the sections which apply, and these are the grounds that are, relevant, which is why you should file an FIR immediately. All of this has to be put on paper in a very, in a legally strong manner. Then it becomes difficult for the police to ignore it. Also, if nothing works, if everybody in your district is a monster, and if the police is not listening, the DM is not listening, nobody is listening, then you always have the 156.3 and you go straight to the district court. You can then get your judgment, your order from the district court to file an FIR. I understand that it sometimes gets very frustrating, but if once or twice you set that precedent in your district, then every Thana will know you, and you would have made it so much easier for everybody else to go to the Thana, because they would know, in ki baat nahi sunenge to court chale jate hain, but always go with very informed set of sections. Consult somebody. If you have to consult me, I'd be happy to share my email ID if there's, you know, on a case-to-case basis. We've got a full law office in Delhi, and we'd be able to assist you in case there are specific situations where, you know, I would ask the students to ask their teachers to help you write a strong FIR and involve some media people. See, those are tactics we use. Involve some media people. Use the social media handles. Escalate your problem. If nothing works, go to court.
Okay. That was a very strong and good suggestion that even if nothing is in hand, at least law is that by your side. And being a law student, I think this is the strong message for our students from you, ma'am. And now one of our students just wants to say that in one case, it was observed that Horn Reno was being shot by 8 bullets for the horn, and then it was left at very famous National Park in spite of very strict security arrangements. So how come, even though the security arrangements and national parks and everything is there, how come all this cruelty is taking place? What are your views in such situation?
Basically, you know, a rhino's horn is actually just a tight bunch of hair. It's nothing other than hair. It just gets bunched up so tightly that it... But it's a rare thing, which whatever is rare is sought after. Everybody wants whatever is limited. So there's a big demand in Chinese medicine and in all kinds of smuggling rackets for rhino horns, and which is why whatever the few rhinos that are left in Kaziranga and Assam and all are all hunted down mercilessly. Now, that's the same, I would say, the, you know, it catches one's eye more in case of a rhino, but it's the same situation with our elephants, with our tigers, with our cobras, with our black bucks, with our snow leopards, with our, you know, even our musk deer. It's all these rare animals are being hunted down all over the place. It's because the government allocates a certain budget for the forest department. They use the budget for other things, and they perhaps, you know, every state you would see is very short-staffed when it comes to guards, actual on-ground forest guards, or, you know, the our guarding system is not correct. In fact, we have been pushing it with the government for a long time that instead of beat guarding, you know, like you give one area of forest or patch of forest to a guard, you know, a few acres or a few kilometers, instead of that, you do an ITBP type of guarding where you have teams of people going crisscross through the forest. So there are methods of guarding which are archaic, not right. There is shortage of guards, which makes all of our national parks unsafe. And forget the rhino. All of our other animals are getting poached. In fact, there's a report that during the lockdown, the poaching cases went up 170 times. So that's, it impacts the rhino, it impacts the deer, it impacts the porcupine, you know, or the pangolins. It impacts everybody. So it's the guarding system. However, the law is very strong. National parks, you can't even enter. But in reality, you can drive inside a national park and nobody would ask you, you know, because there's no guard present. Or if there's a guard present, he doesn't have shoes to walk in the forest. You know, those are real practical problems. So if only people start taking a little more interest in their states to see, you know, what is the forest guard situation. For various things, forest guards need to be in places and with an effective means of, you know, guarding the forest. That seems to be lacking, because I believe, and I, this is not something I'm saying off from the top of my head, I truly believe that among the All India services, the IFS services have not developed as nicely as perhaps the IAS or IPS. It's the forest services that have lagged behind in upgrading their technologies and using their budgets more effectively for guarding the forests. That's only because the animals don't vote. And, you know, the illegal settlers are allowed in, illegal poachers are allowed in, people are sending their cattle inside the forests for grazing, or illegal, you know, felling of trees. It's all, you know, turned a blind eye to. And if you, you know, turn a blind eye to one speck of corruption, there's a whole lot that comes in and you don't even look at it. So it's just a sort of a sad situation for the forest department. And it requires a lot more work to see what is the state. I mean, we worked a lot in Uttarakhand, in the Corbett National Park, in the Rajaji National Park. And the one problem that after working for months, we figured, okay, there's one problem. There's not a single veterinarian who's doing, you know, vaccinations of the buffer area animals, because those buffer area animals are coming in contact, the farm animals in the around the park are coming in contact with the animals which are wild, because wild animals don't know their boundaries. So we set up, we went to High Court, of course, because nothing happens without the courts. And we got an order saying that a, you know, full-fledged veterinary team has to be appointed by the government. They have to be trained by the Wildlife Institute of India. Now they've been put in place and they're doing a fantastic job giving advice to the forest department, getting technical things in place, you know, just to know animal behavior, looking at herd movements in a more scientific way.
Ma'am, your mic is not working. Ma'am, you need to check your connection.
Scientific manner that if, you know, a certain...
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt. There is connection error from your device. Sorry, ma'am. It is connection error from your device. So
a lot of capacity building is required in the forest department to prevent poaching. It's not like a jhatpat solution. It's very intensive, and it requires a lot of situation to situation study. In Assam, regarding the rhino, you said there's a lot of Bangladesh and Nepalese border that is porous and not, you know, if you've ever been to the Bangladesh and Nepal border, you would know that, I mean, there's no border. It's just, you know, you, whether you're standing on the Nepalese side or Indian side, you wouldn't even know sometimes. So those are smuggling routes. And that is why poaching is very high. Even towards Bihar, if you see the Chitwan National Park of Nepal is adjoining our Valmiki Tiger Reserve. So a lot of poaching happens through these border districts, because it's very easy for the smugglers to jump into another country and escape our law. So there perhaps the guarding has to be tighter, the prosecution, the conviction rate has to be higher, but it doesn't happen like that. And that's why perhaps we see a rise in rhino poaching as well.
Is there any suggestion for the stray animals, especially like dog, where the, I mean, where...
I can't hear you. Oh, wait.
Am I audible, ma'am?
I can't hear you.
Now, can I hear me? Well, again, so sorry, ma'am is driving and she was traveling, and due to that, she was having little trouble in getting connected continuously. And there was some technical error, but we have tried to take up many of the questions. Yes, ma'am is again back. So we are.
Yeah, I'm back. I'm back. I'm sorry for the back and forth.
On the contrary, we were just discussing that although you are traveling, your dedication is such, ma'am, even we can see it on your face when you speak. You are just into that matter, and you are narrating all the things. So we are so much, you were so absorbed when you were talking. We are just praising you for that, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, I'll take the next question.
Yes, ma'am. It is just about that. Do you have any suggestion for the stray animals, especially for dogs? who are facing and suffering from casualties due to violent behavior during motor vehicle act, I mean, in accidents. Especially it happens during the night and on the highways. And nobody knows about it.
Yeah. So there are two kinds of accidents. One is that, you know, a genuine accident where it was not intended by anybody, but a dog suddenly comes running and gets hit. In that case, it's expected that if the animal is not right away dead, then the driver should take it to a, you know, nearby hospital or do something. But if it's a hit and run case, now that's a violation. So if somebody has hit an animal and has just, you know, because everybody notices a hit. If I'm driving a car and, sorry?
It is always hit and run if it's a dog. Nobody waits.
Yeah. Yeah, nobody waits. Exactly. So if it's a genuine accident, people would perhaps wait and take the animal to the hospital. But if somebody has hit and run, then it's a violation. And it can be reported. It must be reported to the police. But if you don't know who has hit the animal, the sad thing is nobody would investigate. Nobody would, you know, figure out ki, you know, acha kaun si gaadi chali thi yahan pe, and to check their bumpers, to do a forensic examination and find blood spots, you know, blood spatter on their bumpers, and it's not going to happen. So I would say that. We should, to effectively stop it, one is a preventive measure is to, if there is a highway that happens or a busy road that happens in your colony or whatever, just have all the animals neutered so that they're not making babies on the road more. That's important. And secondly, to have some CCTV cameras around, you know, those areas where, which are accident prone, so that next time an accident happens, you have something to report the police to. Because if you just say that, you know, this animal died on the road, the police is frankly not going to take much interest. And I can understand it because I do a lot of work with the police as well. They don't know where to start from, you know. They wouldn't even know who was the last person to see that animal alive. That, you know, it's just impossible to figure it out. So there has to be cameras. There have to be some amount of neutering taking place. Have to be a little more awareness. I would suggest, like we've done in some cities, put up little boards, you know, on highways saying drive slow, animals sleep on the road, you know, or something like that, which the drivers can read and get reminded, okay, I have to be vigilant, there could be a dog, you know, stuff like that. So taking preventive measures there is more, I'd say, worthy of one's time. But if in a certain colony, like in RWAs, you see fancy apartments and somebody is backing off a car and did not see that a dog is sleeping behind and just crushed it or something. If it's negligent, please report it to the police. If it's not negligent, that man will himself take the, you know, trouble of taking the animal to the doctor. If he does not do that, then that's basically negligent, deliberate violation. I can't hear you. Your mic is off.
Yes, ma'am. One of the faculty members want to know that how difficult it was for you and Menka ma'am and your whole team to uphold the mandate of Environment Ministry and also to tackle the constant pressure from various ministries like trade and commerce, industry, etc., etc. How did you manage that?
Well, when Mrs. Gandhi was Environment Minister, I was way younger at that time and I was managing Uttarakhand at that time more than anything, and there was a lot of issues there. But as the Environment Minister, we had the Animal Welfare Division as well, which is now with the Animal Husbandry Department in the central government. And in the environment, in the Animal Welfare Division, we had the mandate of Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. Therefore, the dog breeding and marketing, sorry, the animal birth control rules, the slaughterhouse rules, the SPCA rules, all these sets of rules are the performing animals registration rules. These are the four sets of rules that were made when Mrs. Gandhi was Environment Minister. Surely there are, you know, pressures of all kinds. But it takes a very upright minister to negate those pressures and go by his or her constitutional and statutory duty. Now, Madam's statutory duty, or any environment minister's statutory duty, is to uphold the acts that he is in charge of. Currently, the Wildlife Protection Act and the Forest Act, Environment Act, Water Act, Air Act, everything is in the charge of a certain environment minister. But I would say that the vermin declarations, like using the Wildlife Protection Act for killing of animals, is something which is very, I'd say, ultra vires to the Act and ultra vires to the Constitution. And also read with the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, it would not stand the scrutiny of law, which is why we have approached the Supreme Court in this matter. I'd say if one is aware of one's duty and is aware of the law, then you would have no difficulty in tackling pressure. But if you're bending to pressure and you don't know your job, then you would mess up. Like, I'd see it slightly messed up right now. But it'll get better. With the leadership that we have, I'm hoping that things would get better with time.
So, ma'am, again, the questions are getting repeated and they are so excited. There are many comments that are saying that it was very informative session. And those who are animal lovers, those who are having pet, along with them, who are just thinking that what is the actual meaning of coexistence? Human being is not the only one who is living on the earth. They have to learn the true meaning of coexistence. They felt that it was really made clear, and they actually enjoyed this question answers when you are sharing your knowledge for that. And many are asking that we want to know more information about the same. But as you said, you'll be sharing some of the literature, and we will be, with your kind consent, we will be spreading it to the students and those who actually wish to work with it. We would be more than happy, as Dr. Mayuri Pandya said, under her guidance, and as you, along with Minta Gandhi, ma'am, as per your suggestion, we would like to work on that. And we really enjoyed each and every suggestion that you have given, that students, and especially it is those who are law students, can really make wonders if they really understand that. And one point is noted, ma'am, which you mentioned very particularly, that as much importance is given to IAS or IPS, same importance has not been given to IFS, and that's why it needs so much development, and the approach has to be developed for formation of law, for PILs, and for any other thing. Our students, especially from environmental law department, law clinic, we are all ready to help you in whichever way we could for that, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Mehta. I leave you with two thoughts. One is that I want everyone to Google for a film called Earthlings. That, I think, will show you what coexistence is. And then you would be able to connect every law, whether there are provisions in Municipal Corporation Acts for controlling animals, or in PC Act for preventing cruelty. You would all put it together if you'll watch this little one-hour film called Earthlings. It's a little difficult and painful to watch, but I think the pain that humankind has inflicted upon millions of animals on this earth will not go away by our shutting our eyes to it. If you shut your eyes to it like a turtle, the pain is not going to go away. It's all around you. Once you see it, you would perhaps be able to devise solutions for it. So make your heart a little tough. Understand what they go through, understand and know, the problem. The better you know the problem, the better you will be able to devise a solution. So both of these things go hand in hand. So watch Earthlings, and if you want dedicated sessions, say on slaughterhouses or Wildlife Protection Act, then we can have that in a more office environment. Today was a little bit of a runaround, but maybe we can have more dialogue at some point, and I'd be very happy to share some study material for all you guys, and you can make use of that and even ask questions on email. I'd be happy to answer those.
It's more than asked, ma'am, it would be great if you can share all the details, literature, and as you said, through email. And yes, we will share all the links to the students with your permission once you say. And please. Yes, all the questions will also send it through email. And it was a great session on the e-learning platform of GLS Law College. We are so honored to have you and Inka Gandhi, ma'am, to have with us today. And I'm sure that it would be a long association with GLS Law College. And we are so happy to work and join hands along with people for animals. Thank you so much,
ma'am. Thank you, Dr. Bye-bye. Have a good day. Stay safe.